to have Leonardo Senatore from Stanford University, and he will give a single lecture about asymptotic behavior cosmologies with positive cosmological constant. Please.
So thank you very much to the organizer for being here in this beautiful, interesting school between two different fields. I will talk about this research line, which is, as we just heard, is called asymptotic behavior of a cosmology with positive cosmological constant. Contrary to what you heard in the former lectures, this is not really a well-established, famous problem in mathematics or generativity, nor it is one of the foundational issues of generativity, like initial value problem. However, as you will see, is a problem that concerns something very physical about the beginning of the universe. And for about 30 years or so, we didn't know how to make progress. In the last few years, thanks to some mathematical techniques that I will explain, we were able to make progress. And so I think it's interesting for you to know about this. So first of all, therefore, let me explain the physical motivation. So what do we want to do? Before I start, if something is unclear or my handwriting is not beautiful as it is, just feel free to interrupt me any time. I can repeat anything, okay? So our universe now is accelerating, but in the past, very recently, it was decelerating. And the fact that the universe was decelerating for a very long time, the time of the cosmic microwave radiation, the time of Big Bang nuclear synthesis, created some problems, because a universe like that is unstable under inhomogeneities. It tends to, the inhomogeneity tends to grow, and the curvature tends to grow, and the universe tends to recollapse. So decelerating universe is unstable, tends to recollapse. And then in the 80s, when people realized this, it was a mystery why the universe is not where we live, why the universe is so big and everything is smooth on large scales, why it's like that. And because of this, in the 80s, some people came out with the theory of inflation. Inflation is a period that is postulated to happen before the epoch of deceleration of the universe, before Big Bang nuclear synthesis, when the atoms are formed, the nucleus are formed. And it is supposed to be an epoch where the universe takes as the following form. So there is the matter of the universe is dominated by a scalar field with the Lagrangian d phi squared plus v of phi minus v of phi, where and the potential has the following property. So there is a scalar field with some potential energy, and the potential is very, very flat. Okay, there is a region where the potential is non-zero and very, very flat. So people realize that if you take a region of space and you fill it up with phi of x and t equal to be a constant in space. That is, if you take a region of space, fill it up with a scalar field constant sitting on top of the potential, okay? And if the scalar field, this region, is as large such that the inverse length of this region, H inverse, we call H inverse I, such that this H I is given by the potential energy at this point over M plus square, or G Newton. Okay. If the universe, there is a chunk of space where the field is homogeneous on this region, on this size, and if the potential is flat enough, then one can solve the equation and find that the universe expands, the universe is homogeneous. Then the matrix is the following form. Ds squared is minus dt squared plus a square of t dx squared. So this is an homogeneous universe. It's called the Friedmann-Robertson-Walker metric. and the universe expands exponentially. E to the ht, where h is a constant given by this inflationary h. It is constant because the potential energy is constant. What will happen is that the field rolls down very, very slowly down the potential because there is a slope. But the slope is very small, so it's slowing down very slowly. Hubble, therefore, changes very slowly in time because the potential is quite constant. And therefore, the universe pretty much expands exponentially during this time. This is an acceleration, accelerating universe. A double dot over A is h squared, it's positive. And the universe expands exponentially. Locally, it is the same as the Sitter space. For some time, it is the same as the Sitter space. And then at some point, the flat region stops, it drops to the bottom, and inflation ends. And the normal epoch of Big Bang cosmology, radiation domination, Big Bang nuclear synthesis starts. Okay. So this is a very important phase that we think it happened before what is called the Big Bang. It's the first epoch of the universe that we normally know of, and it's called inflation. And there are many experimental evidence supporting this, observation evidence that supporting this what happened. Okay. Now, the problem was the following. There is a problem, however, for inflation, since a few years after the initial formulation of inflation. The point is that, as you saw, we postulated inflation to solve why the universe is so large and homogeneous on scales, the scales that we probe now, which is the Hubble scale that we probe now, which is the Hubble scale now. That's the scales that we probe. But in order to what I described so far, I assumed that initially there was a scalar field homogeneous in a big region of space. How big? Big as the Hubble patch, Hubble's Hubble rate during inflation. So now, the Hubble rate during inflation is very small. We're talking about maybe 10 to the 13 GV, so it's a very, very small length. But in terms of Hubble, it's still an Hubble length. So very few years after the formulation of inflation, there was the question of how likely is to be in these conditions, okay? How likely is to find yourself in this top in a smooth region so large on top of the potential, okay? And more in general, how likely is for inflation to start? And this is called the initial patch problem. And this was born maybe 85, this problem, and it was very hard to make progress. And it's highly debated, as typical with problems that one cannot solve. There is a lot of discussions and angry people. If you open a Scientific American every 5 years, there is the cover saying, oh, blah, blah, very people upset. And the reason why it was hotly debated is because if you want to understand how the universe becomes homogeneous, you have to start from a very non-homogeneous universe, okay? So, and therefore, very inhomogeneous universe. Are hard to make any progress for two reasons. One could try to solve numerically the evolution. One can take an inhomogeneous universe and solve numerically. But in an inhomogeneous universe, as you just heard in the former lecture, tends to have singularities. So numerically, you need a code. Numerically, one needs to handle singularities. And this is hard. In fact, it wasn't possible until the codes that were developed to study gravitational waves were developed. And analytically, as you heard, in general, it's hard. Whenever analytically, it's obviously hard. We can make some statement about non-homogeneous universe, like, for example, the Perron singularity or incompleteness theorems. I was at the lecture, so I call them incomplete theorem. And but it's hard, okay. There's no, in particular, probably was not made. Now, in the last few years, we were able to make progress in these two camps. First, when you heard from the lecture from Nico Nunes, we have now codes that can handle singularities, the black hole singularities that describe mergers of binary black holes. Well, there is a numerical code that solves your equation solving with singularities, and we can do the same for early universe cosmologies. So there are numerical codes that are available. And if you ask yourself, let me simulate a big universe, a torus, full of with the scalar field completely inhomogeneous. This is a numerical experiment we did a few years ago. You take a toroidal universe, you let it go, completely inhomogeneous. You will find that after some times here there is a big black hole, but in most of the numerical code finds some black hole here, but in the space between, one finds that the universe expands exponentially and becomes actually infinitely large. Okay, so numerically, we first experimental evidence that inflation actually was starting out of inhomogeneous universe. There was singularities were forming, but somewhere in the manifold, the universe inflation was always starting. And in particular, in the numerical experiment, we were finding that the universe always starts inflating. And so this suggested that the existence of a theorem that we will formulate, which suggests that the universe, depending on the topology of the manifold, if you have an inhomogeneous universe but initially expanding everywhere, inflation always starts somewhere. Okay? And there are analytic techniques that are not completely new, but at least were new to us, or to some physicists, that allows us to handle a bit this problem. Okay, of physical interest, there will be an analytic theory that we're going to prove in this lecture, saying basically that inflation always starts in some topologies. And of physical interest is the case of 3 plus 1 dimension, which is our universe. We live in 3 plus 1 dimension. Here there are only partial results. Work is in progress, and I think it's a very interesting topic. But in this lecture, I will show you the proof of the full theorem in 2 plus 1 dimension, the theorem that basically says that if you take a 2 plus 1 dimensional cosmology, initially expanding, for all topology except one, inflation always starts. Even though, notwithstanding the size of the initial perturbations and notwithstanding the fact that one forms many black holes and singularities here and there. Okay, so we will prove in this lecture, we will prove the following theorem, which I will formulate next, but it has the following assumptions. So the first assumption is that we're dealing with a cosmology. The manifold is a cosmology. What is a cosmology? The cosmology is what we also in physics we call a space-time manifold, which means that for simplicity, I will keep general n dimensions, and then at some point we'll specify to 2 plus 1 dimensions, so n plus 1 to 2 plus 1. N plus 1 dimension is an n plus 1 dimensional manifold. It's a cosmology if the topology is R cross MN, where M, okay, let's call it M, where R is time and M is the spatial manifold. MN is a compact, okay, for simplicity, we take the compact N manifold. The property, this has been proven by Gerock that this statement is equivalent to the following fact, that the manifold, that m plus 1 can be foliated by a family MT of manifolds, where T is the parameter called time, okay, is the time of the space-time, and the MT are all with all the same topology. Same topology, and MT are Cauchy surfaces. Among four physics, this is the manifolds we're interested in, because they tell you that, okay, each slice, there is a Cauchy surface, and the topology doesn't change. It's what we really mean by space-time. Okay, so roughly speaking, there are many, the manifold is, can be foliated by maybe complicated empty slices, all with some time directions orthogonal to them. Okay, then another assumption we'll do. So this is the manifold we deal with. Then in particular, okay, you can see that we're checking this T, where T, this time here, goes from T0 to plus infinity. So there is a beginning of time, T0, and then the universe goes. And we want to see what happens to the end. Then we have to say something about the energy, the matter. Matter satisfies the dominant energy condition that you already saw in several lectures. And the strong energy condition. But there is also a cosmological constant bigger than zero that is treated separately. This is the cosmological constant does not satisfy the strong energy condition, but it is there, and the rest of the matter satisfy this. So the dominant energy condition is the following quantity. It means that this is called dec, and this is sec. So dec means that minus t mu nu k nu is a future-directed time-like or nihil vector for any time-like k nu, vector k mu. A consequence of dec, notice that dec implies the weak energy condition, which tells that t mu nu, k mu k nu, is bigger than zero, bigger or equal to zero, for any time-like vector k nu. And this is simply tell you that the energy density is positive, okay? The energy density is positive. And usually, I always find these energy conditions very, very reasonable, apart from the cosmological constant that tends to violate many of them. But indeed, here we're talking about the stuff that is not the cosmological constant. And the strong energy condition is the statement that T mu nu minus 1 over n minus 1 G mu nu T contracted with the same time-like vectors, k mu, k nu, is bigger or equal to zero. Okay? And this is for any future-directed, future time-like vector, future-directed time-like vector, k nu. And for a perfect fluid, means that rho plus p is bigger or equal to zero, and rho plus 3p is bigger or equal to zero. For normal fluid, physically means that gravity is attractive. Okay, if matter is dominating, is the energy content of the universe is dominated by this kind of matter, gravity is attractive. Geodesically converge. So this is the matter that we will deal with. And then, as I mentioned in the numerical experiment, but also as it is intuitive, the universe will we're dealing with an initial expanding universe. It starts going, but it's inhomogeneous, so we'll form singularities. So we have to talk about singularities. There will be singularities in the manifold, but we don't know where they are. We're interested in very complicated initial conditions. So we're going to make an assumption about the singularity. The only space-time singularities that we're dealing with are of the crashing kind. And which I'm going to define next. Before I define this, let me just say one more thing, that when we specify to 2 plus 1 dimension, that is for n equal 2, the topology will be such that the Euler characteristic chi, which is the Euler characteristic of the Euler characteristic of the manifold, must be less or equal to 0, which means not S2. So all topologies, but S2, or I never remember if it's here or here. I don't know. Probably here. 50-50. Okay, not this two sphere. Okay, it's not the theory. We don't have a theorem for the two sphere. Okay. Okay. So in this assumption, we don't know what is a crashing singularity. Okay, let me define what is a crashing singularity.
Sorry.
Yes. Yes, it is. I would say it's the normalized cosmological cause. The matter satisfies. You're right. I mean, there is a bit of the cosmological cause has been subtracted by the matter, because otherwise it violates the strong energy condition. Good question. Yeah, thanks. Also, please ask questions. Okay, it's good. In fact, at quantum level, these energy conditions, exactly because of your questions, become a bit tricky. Exactly because I think your question is one way to say why it's complicated. At quantum level, it's. Okay, so we need to define to be able to talk about the singularity. So let me give a definition. Okay. So basically, what we're dealing with, a manifold. Okay, it will evolve, and some place there will be a black hole, maybe here. But in other regions, things are fine, okay? Things will be fine, okay? We want to be able to describe the situations, like in our universe. This is a realistic situation, like our universe, okay? So first we need to define a future crashing function. If you share crashing function, t tilde, is a function defined on the full manifold, mn plus 1, okay, such that in a global hyperbolic neighborhood, which we call N, then in N times intersected, the region where this crashing function is bigger than some constant, then t tilde is a Cauchy time function. We range from C0 all the way to infinity. Okay, a Cauchy-Time function, it simply says that the surface of constant time, constant tilde, are Cauchy slices. So basically there is, around the singularity, there will be some surfaces. Okay, let me do in this way. So this is, imagine this is the singularity. Okay, and so there is an hyperbolic neighborhood of the singularity where there are these Cauchy slices of constant t tilde time, identified by t tilde, from some constant all the way to infinity. Okay. And the level set, okay, if you want, this is called SC, the constant, the level sets SC, such that t tilde is equal a constant on the surface. There is an extrinsic curvature, the second fundamental for the trace of the second fundamental for the extrinsic curvature, the trace of the extrinsic curvature is less than minus C. Okay, what does it mean physically? Means that there is a single, we want to say that here there is a singularity. How do we say it mathematically? We say, okay, first of all, we define a crashing time function that is in the neighborhood of the singularity, there must be this function which is foliating Cauchy surfaces around the singularity, and as you approach the singularity, the level set of this time function have more and more extrinsic curvature negative. That is, the volume is going to zero, because the extrinsic curvature is how the volume changes. Minus infinity means that the volume is just going to zero. An observer there surely dies, okay? If you were in the former lecture, that really means that it's not good, okay? It's very, very bad. For Schwarzschild, for example, these surfaces would be naturally the equal inside horizon constant radius surface. As you change the radius, the constant radius surfaces is a crashing function. Okay. So we should say that the cosmology, which is our manifold, has only singularity of the crashing kind, which is what we want to deal with. If there is an open set N, in this picture, this is N, okay? This set here is N, okay? If there is an open set N, such that outside of N, the lapse of the time function, which is called N is such that N to the minus 2 is well, is the, if you write the metric, is d mu t. Okay, so outside of this region, the lapse n is bounded. And N contains a crashing function and for T tilde less than C. So if you take a certain level set and you look other than that, then the lapse is bounded. Okay. Okay, this is a mathematical way to describe what is the, for example, a black hole singularity. Okay, it's shielded by a crashing function, which means that as you, there is a foliation that if you go to hit, the volume shrinks to zero. And as soon as you are outside of this given level set, the lapse is bounded, okay? So this means that the singularity can be reached a finite time. Generically, this space-time will be geodesically incomplete because the lapse goes to infinity, so this infinite proper time, it can be reached. But as soon as you are a finite distance, everything is fine, okay? So this is a way that we have to describe the singularities. And physically, we think that these are the way the singularity happen. Probably, one can find mathematical solutions where the singularities are not shielded by a crashing function, but in realistic, in physical situation, we expect this to be the case. And then, okay, with this hypothesis, okay, the theorem is the following. Okay, given all these hypotheses, the spatial volume goes to infinity. Okay. At late times, where times is going to be defined in a way that you will see next. Okay. And at the same late times, and the space time. Converges on average to the Sitter space, okay, DS, the Sitter space, okay, and there are arbitrary large regions where physics, where observers feel that is any experiment they gives the same result as in the Sitter space. Okay, so this manifold starts, goes on, forms the singularities, but reaches infinite volume. On average, everywhere looks at the Sitter space, and there are big, arbitrary large chunk of spaces where experimentalists will always find themselves in the Sitter space. This is the statement that there is probability one, then somewhere the Sitter space will be formed. Okay, now one thing I realized I forgot to say is that the physical motivation for this was the inflation, was to prove that inflation always starts with some topology, so there is no tuned initial conditions in order to have a universe that undergoes inflation. But now I'm talking about the cosmological cost and the Sitter space. The reason is the following, I forgot to say, sorry. Remember that an inflationary potential is like this. An inflationary phase is when the inflaton, the scalar field that drives dominates the matter during inflation, sits here. Well, if the potential, inflation really means that the potential is very, very flat. It happens only if the potential is very, very flat. And in this region, the potential is very similar to this, which is a cosmological constant. So to have a simple treatment, we will approximate the potential as a cosmological constant. So for us, saying that inflation starts means that the universe is dominated by the cosmological constant and becomes the Sitter space. Okay. So this is the problem. Our hypothesis, that's what we want to prove. Yes? Yes. Yes, finite volume, then they go at infinite time, the volume, of course, at each time, the volume is always finite, but there is no bound. Given any finite volume, there is a time when it will be reached. Okay, it grows unbounded. Yes, that's a good question. No, in the true, very good, very good. So this is the difference between the model, in the mathematical model, and true inflation. So it's true. When in the true universe, now, until a billion years ago, we were not inflating. So inflation could not last, better not last forever in our universe. In fact, if you take this scalar field potential, it will roll very, very slowly because the potential is very flat, but inflation will last a finite amount of time, and then it ends. Typically last, the universe expands by e to the 60, which is a big number, very close to infinity, right? E to the 60 is big. So to show that inflation starts, it's enough to approximate it with the cosmological constant. Of course, the difference is that, one of the difference, important difference, is that once it's, if you have a cosmological constant, it will never end. But that's not really, it's good. So this is an incompleteness of the model, but it's not the question we're trying to address. The question which was interesting is how it starts. Nobody has once it starts, we know how to stop it. Because once it starts, the universe is quickly becomes homogeneous. Inflation is the city space, it's very homogeneous. We can do calculations, and since 82, people established how to end inflation. People didn't know how to start. So the question was, how do we start? That's why this modeling approximation is good. It's good enough for our purposes. Thank you. Okay, so there is this modeling, and then that's what we are trying to prove. How are we going to prove it? Again, there is an initially expanding slice. The sensitive curvature is positive everywhere. This is what is called a Big Bang, but it's very inhomogeneous, very big, very small, completely inhomogeneous. It will evolve, and maybe somewhere, as I said, we will form black holes, and somewhere else we will evolve. We assume that the manifold satisfies the generativity equation, and how do we know? We expect it, we have some intuition that tells us that, or numerical experimental evidence that tells us that it will go to the city space in most places. How do we establish this? Well, we will use a probe. We will use a probe to explore what is the manifold. So the manifold satisfies m plus 1 g, which is obtained by solving general relativity equation. Okay, and we will try to learn what is this manifold by using a probe. The probe would be a spatial slice, but it could be the initial spatial slice. Okay, we'll take a spatial slice, and we will try to foliate space using this slice, this spatial slice, and so we'll take a spatial slice and we'll define a flow. We'll try to foliate the space, so we'll define a flow with the spatial slice, trying to cover the whole manifold, and then if we have we have foliated all the space with a manifold, we look at the metric every time and this, we see what it is. Okay, so we'll define a flow, and the flow is called, we will use a flow. Called mean curvature flow. What is this flow? The flow is defined in the following way. Take a slice, and imagine that there is there is a Big Bang slice, then time go on, and maybe this region is going to form a black hole, right? So maybe here, the sensitive curvature is negative, that is, it's going to contract and form a black hole. And maybe here is positive. We're trying to see that there is the city space. So we will like the surface to go where there is the city space. The moment we know that there is the city space, we're happy. Maybe somewhere else there is black holes, but it's fine. So there is a deformation that you can define. Say that you move the surface forward in time, take a special surface. You can move the surface forward in time if the sensitive curvature is positive, or backward in time if the sensitive curvature is negative, okay? By an amount proportional to k. Okay, so you can define a flow that the variation with respect to the flow parameter lambda of the flow is proportional to the extrinsic curvature of the manifold, of the three manifold, times the normal along the normal direction to the manifold. Okay, so this is what mean curvature flow is. It's the flow of the surface proportional to the volume. This is It's a well-established field in mathematics, but in the context of Riemannian geometry. In the semi-Riemannian geometry, like in our case, it is less well-known, but for our case, it's very nice, because you see that and it will be very helpful for our purposes. Because the trace of the CC curvature is the variation, maybe this effect of two, of the relative variation of the volume of the spatial volume of the surface. If H is the induced metric on the spatial slice, okay, the CC curvature is the variation of the volume. So if you're moving forward the surface, where K is positive, means that I'm letting the volume grow. Here, going backward, here the volume was decreasing moving forward. So if I let the volume go back, the volume is grow. So the flow will tend to make the volume increase. And if we're talking about a three-dimensional or a two-dimensional manifold in 2 plus 1 dimension, that is a co-dimension 1 manifold where the extra dimension is time, in the Lorentzian constant, if you try to make a surface grow, the volume of the surface grow, you have to smooth it out. For example, in the Euclidean constant, if you want to make a path very, very fast, very, very long, you do this. So a very singular path is very long, okay? So if you try to make the mean curvature flow in the Euclidean, in the Riemannian geometry, it becomes very singular very quickly. But if the path is codimension one, something like, if you start with a space like a path and you try to make this, you go through null. And null has zero length or zero volume. So you don't want to do that. You just want to stay flat. So the mean curvature flow makes the volume grow, and also is very smooth. So this flow has a lot of regularity properties that I will mention. So this flow will not become singular on its own. It could be singular if it hits some singularities, if it lives in a space which is bad, which is not great. But you see that the intuition is the following. Whenever there was a singularity, it was shielded by a crashing time function, which means that the volume there was going to zero. And so it's intuitive that if the flow is in front, gets somehow in front of a black hole, it will try not to go there, because the flow wants to maximize the volume. And here, the volume will go to zero. So the flow will not hit the singularity. And on its own, it stays calm. If it lives in a smooth manifold, it stays smooth. So this flow exists, and for some times, and will allow you to explore. In particular, trying to maximize the volume, we'll try to follow a space where there is a lot of volume. And the Sitte space produces infinite volume, so we'll try to go where the Sitte space is. Okay, that's the intuition behind why mean curvature flow is useful. And all these statements, we're gonna prove them next. Okay. In fact, let's start by proving the existence of the flow. Okay, it's a very, very simple exercise that... yes, thank you. Yeah, sure.
Definition of future regression function. You say that if n should be bounded for t...
Yes.
That c wasn't a constant defined in the level sets, isn't it? So actually a constant or...
Yeah, sorry, it's... Yeah, thank you. T is bounded by a C-dependent constant. That is here. Yeah, thank you. It's bounded. Then you go forward. It's still bounded by larger constant, but the past of the Cauchy slice is well-behaved. Nothing happens until you hit the C-infinity slice. Okay? Thank you. Yes? I mean, the SC, sorry, thank you very much. This SC, defined by the level set T tilde equal constant. K tilde is the mean curvature of the slices of T tilde equal constant. Yeah, very good. These are...
And then you define two symbols and one
Yes, and unfortunately, yes, good. So, and the open, okay, the open set. This is script n, is the set. And then there's the lapse n, yes, I apologize, it's terrible. The n square is the lapse. You know what is the lapse? Okay, given a time function, the lapse is d mu t d mu t. Yeah. And d mu, ah. Wow. Okay, you will never believe that the theorem is true now, right? I do so many mistakes that the theorem, okay, check the theorem, because maybe it's wrong. Okay. 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 So, oh, thanks for the question. I mean, if something is unclear, please ask questions because we can fix them quickly. Unless we cannot fix them, and then it's a problem. Okay, but we'll try. Okay. So, okay. So it's a simple exercise to derive the equation that if you define the flow in this way or in this way, how the mean curvature evolves. It's in the reference I gave you, a pedagogical derivation, a physicist derivation, rigorous but understandable. Because if you look at the math paper, many people don't, like me, cannot understand it. So, okay, it's very simple to derive that the change on the extrinsic curvature under the flow is following this equation. It's similar to the Ricciarelli equation, or in math settings, also Ricciarelli equation, but it's not quite the same. Okay, so this is the equation. I want to, some of you might be familiar with the Ricciarelli-Ricciarelli equation. This equation which tells you how the convergent geodesic move along the geodesic flow. This equation is not that. It cannot be that because as we are moving the surface, we are the normal vector, which the extrinsic curvature is the gradient of it, has to stay normal to the surface, which is not the case for the geodesic flow. So it's not quite the same, but it's similar. Okay, in particular, there is no, this is the Laplacian on the surface, and then the Ricciarelli equation doesn't have that. Laplacian surface. And then there is K lambda square is basically the cosmological constant, the extrinsic curvature that you have in a De Sitter space with that cosmological constant, okay? And R-mu nu meter is the combination of T-mu nu that satisfies the strong energy condition, apart from 8 pi g. In fact, sec implies that R-mu nu meter and mu and nu bigger or equal to zero. This combination, apart from the K multiplication, is the combination that enters also in the Hawking-Perros incompleteness theorem is the thing that tells you that geodesics tends to converge. Okay. In fact, another way to say what we're trying to prove is an anti-Penrose Hawking theorem, in the sense that Penrose Hawking tells you that there will be a singularity somewhere. A corollary of this theorem tells you that there cannot be a singularity everywhere. Somewhere the universe will keep expanding, okay? So there can be many singularities, but somewhere the universe will go on. So no global crunch theorem, okay? Yes.
Sorry, what's
sigma? Thank you, yes. This is the next thing. Yes, sorry. K mu nu is 1 over n k h mu nu, where h mu nu is the induced matrix plus sigma nu. It's the traceless part of the extrinsic curvature, the extrinsic curvature. Okay. There are interesting properties that I will not prove, but are properties that are intuitive of mean curvature flow. Is the induced matrix, the first fundamental form. Okay, so if a surface is space-like, it will remain so. Why? Because the flow tends to maximize the volume, wants the volume to increase. If you locally become null, the volume is zero, so you will not become null. Okay, at most you stay. Okay? And the second property, this all can be proven rigorously, and if the property, k bigger than zero is preserved. K bigger or equal to zero is preserved. That is, if you start with a surface, as we will do, that is initially expanding everywhere, the mean curvature flow will have mean curvature positive everywhere. Again, why? Because the mean curvature flow surface. Why? Because, again, if k is zero, then you stop evolving. The flow stops. So wherever k is zero, it stops. It never becomes negative. Okay? Okay. So we want to prove that the flow exists. This is the evolution of the flow. Ah, maybe I should have kept this. Okay, first we prove a theorem, which we can be called the press, which basically tells us the following thing, that let M lambda be a solution of the mean curvature flow, starting from in the interval M lambda, okay, a solution to mean curvature flow in the interval lambda 1, lambda 2, okay, inside in the full manifold, m, m plus 1, okay. Suppose it exists a point x lambda with lambda in with lambda here in the interval, such that the extrinsic curvature of x lambda is bigger than k lambda. Okay. Then if km of lambda is max, is the maximum of k in m lambda. And the maximum exists because M lambda is a compact manifold. Then the following inequality holds. Then the maximum of the extrinsic curvature at the time lambda 2 is less or equal than k lambda plus an exponentially small correction, asymptotically 2 over n, the maximum k lambda 1 minus k lambda. Okay, so this is a theorem that tells you that given a slice on the flow, there will be a maximum value okay, of the extrinsic curvature on this slice, and this maximum has to converge to k lambda. So as lambda goes on, this is k lambda, the extrinsic curvature of the city space, and there is a bound like this, okay? Maybe it takes some time if the flow starts with a very, very high extrinsic curvature, but it will go there. Okay, let me prove it. The proof is a simple application of the maximum principle. Proof. Okay, consider W, write down W as e to the alpha k minus k lambda. Okay, so it's how much is e to the alpha lambda, sorry. An exponential constant times k minus k lambda. Okay, then that equation here, I mean, is a simple change of variable, tells you that d lambda of w minus the Laplace of w plus 1 over n k plus k lambda minus n alpha times w plus non-negative terms, Okay, it's equal to zero. So this is the equation for W. Okay, and let's consider the competent interval lambda 1, lambda 2, where the flow exists, where I assume it times m0. Okay. Now, W, you see that by hypothesis, the maximum in this interval is bigger than k lambda. So W is, so first of all, we're considering a compact interval. So there is a maximum, there is a global maximum for W, and at the maximum, the maximum is positive. So max of W. Okay. So at the maximum, if the maximum is not at the initial point, lambda 1, okay, then if the maximum, suppose that the maximum, look at this equation at the maximum. Suppose the maximum is not at lambda 1. Then this the first derivative can be bigger or equal to 0, because at the maximum, if you are in the interval, okay, if the point is contained in the interval, the derivative is zero, but if the final point, it could still be positive. The only point where it could be negative if it is the first point. But if it's not at the initial point, then this is bigger or equal to zero. Then this term is also bigger or equal to zero because the maximum of Laplace is bigger or equal to zero. Okay, for n small enough, you can choose the n small enough, that this is bigger or equal to zero. Okay. Sorry, this is bigger than zero for n small enough. Okay, and plus the negative term. So you get zero bigger than zero. Okay, and for n, if n is smaller than 2 over n over k lambda square. So the maximum is lambda zero. Is at lambda equal lambda 1. And then it follows simply the theorem. Okay, then the maximum, then it follows this statement is true. Okay. So the Stacey curvature cannot be quickly, exponentially fast in time, quickly will come on this surface. The fastest the Stacey curvature will be of order k lambda. Okay, and now with this statement we can prove, we can see that we can use the following existing theorem. This is approved by people like Eskin and Eskin-Uskin. Okay, that tells you that there exists a unique continuous infinite differentiable solution to mean curvature flow, okay, in the interval zero lambda zero for some lambda zero. This statement is semi-trivial. Given this differential equation with smooth initial condition, for some times the solution will exist. Okay, for some lambda zero, it exists. Okay. Now the non-trivial part is that if the flow stays in a smooth and compact part of the part of manifold of mn plus 1, then the solution can be extended. So the second part of the statement is what is non-trivial. It tells you that as long as the flow stays in a compact region of the manifold, okay, so if this is the manifold, okay, this is time, this is the slices, as long as the flow doesn't run away to infinity, okay, and it doesn't hit some singularity of the manifold, then the flow exists, and so one can keep the solution exists. So as long as this doesn't happen, there is a global solution in lambda all the way to infinity, from zero to for the time all the way to zero to infinity. Now, because I've been a bit slow, I will skip the proof that that in our situation, these two requisites, these two hypotheses hold. And therefore, the flow holds. The flow exists at all times. But it's quite intuitive. And let me explain you. First, the flow stays in a compact region of the flow. Well, it's pretty clear why it's so. If I have time, I will prove it, but I doubt I will have time. So you see that the advancement of the flow is dictated by k. K is the speed at which the flow advances in time. But we saw that the maximum of k is bounded by k lambda. So there is a limiting speed the flow reaches. The flow at most advances at k lambda speed. In particular, one can easily show that actually, yeah, this is the speed. And therefore, since the flow advances in time a finite speed, for finite time, it's a finite, it stays always in a compact region. That is, staying in a compact region of the manifold means that you never go to the embedding, the time function of the manifold. It doesn't reach infinity for finite lambda. And it cannot because it advances at most at k lambda speed. Okay, so it stays in this compact region. And it's also possible to prove that it stays in a smooth region because, as we discussed, if this is the manifold, the singularities are shielded by the crashing function. A crashing function is some other Fourier show with k tilde is negative. And it's quite intuitive that it's provable that if there is a Cauchy slice of this neighborhood where k tilde is negative, the flow, which has k positive, will never intersect this region. There's a contradiction argument that shows you that the flow will not penetrate this region because if it did, it would decrease the volume, and it doesn't want to do it. Okay, if there is time, I'll prove it, but this is intuition. But given that these two are very, seems to be, I mean, I gave intuition why that's true, then the flow can be extended at all times. So now we have a flow that exists at all time, and we don't need to worry about it, and then we simply see what it does. Okay. Okay, so this is our instrument, okay? Our instrument to explore this manifold, which I remind you we don't know very much. But we have this instrument that allows us to explore it. And now we're gonna see a few facts. Yeah, that's it. So let's start by saying that the volume goes to infinity. What does it mean that the volume goes to infinity? We're going to check that the mean curvature flow slices, which are particular slices of this volume, go to infinity. Okay, here we're going to work in two dimensions. Okay, we take Einstein equation, g mu nu equal a pi g t mu nu. Our manifold satisfies the Einstein equation. And we contract twice with m mu and nu, okay? We take this particular equation. Now, one can use Gauss-Kodaczy to write this equation as R2, when in two dimensions, plus 1 half k squared minus sigma mu nu squared equal 1 half k lambda squared plus 16 pi g t mu nu and mu and nu. Okay. Now, the mean curvature flow, we can ask how much the volume changes of our surface changes as how much has the volume of our mean curvature flow slices changes with the flow, dv in the lambda, what it is the integral of the change. You see, there is a k here. We move forward the proportional to k, and now the volume is the derivative. This is the, we have to do dv lambda of square root of g. But dv lambda of square root of g is dv dt of square root of g, which gives us a k. And now we do the derivative between dt and d lambda, there's another k, so this is a k square. Intuitively, the change in volume is positive under mean curvature flow. Okay, okay, that's all what we said all the time. Now let me plug back this equation. Okay, so this becomes equal integral d2x square root of h of, okay, for now I will stop, I will forget the numbers, okay, I will not keep track of the numbers. Oh, okay, 32 pi g t mu nu and mu nu plus k lambda square plus 2 sigma square minus 2 r2. Okay. Now, this is positive. This is, remember that the weak energy condition says that this is positive. So this is bigger or equal of k lambda square. K lambda square is a constant, so the integral of d2 square root of a is volume, v of lambda, okay, plus the integral of r2, okay, minus 2 the integral of r2. But the integral of r2 is the Euler characteristic in two dimensions, so this is equal to k lambda square v of lambda, okay, minus a pi chi. Now you can see that if chi is negative or even zero, then this is a positive, so this is bigger or equal than k lambda square v lambda for all the manifold, not S2. Okay, so the derivative, you see, dv in d lambda, the derivative is positive at all times, so the volume goes to infinity. And in particular, this equation can be solved and tells you and it tells you that v of lambda is bigger or equal than some v0 times e to the k lambda square lambda plus more one plus corrections that go like, okay, let's chi over v0 plus correction that are exponentially small. Okay, so this is the volume goes to infinity. Okay, how does it go to infinity? Goes as faster than the city, faster or equal than the volume of the slice of the city space, okay? So this is faster, this is the city space growth of volume, okay? Now, it's, so the rate of growth is faster or equal to the city space. The claim is that we're gonna go to the city space, so now we can prove that the flow will grow, the volume will grow slower or equal than the city space, so this means that it grows like the city space. Okay, if, let me do it for simplicity for a case where the Euler characteristic is negative, so for example, a torus with some holes, okay? Yes? Ah, thank you. Sigma square is the extrinsic, the trace, the traces part of the extrinsic curvature. Sigma mu nu, and this is sigma mu nu square. Ah, thank you. Sigma mu nu square, thank you. No, this is not a trace. This is the square, like sigma 1, 2, sigma 1, 2. Okay, yeah, thank you. But I wrote sigma, and sigma was very misleading. But now it's fine. Okay, thank you, thank you. Yeah, but it, so it's, yeah, okay. Yeah, okay, but I'm being pretty fast here. So now let's show that the rate is bounded by the one of the city space from below, from above. Okay, consider a case where chi is negative, which are, by the way, most of the manifold. Okay, this means that the integral of R2 must be negative, means at least at one point R2 is negative. At this point, R2 is negative, okay? And this is negative, okay? And this is positive. So at that point, K is bigger than K lambda, okay? So it exists a point, exists XP with K of XP bigger than K lambda, okay? And this means that the theorem of the press that I showed you before, the theorem that tells you that the maximum of the sensitive curvature goes to K lambda up to exponentially small corrections in lambda time holds. And this means that the maximum of the sensitive curvature basically becomes K lambda. But the maximum of the sensitive curvature, you see that the V in the lambda is equal to the integral of square root of H K square, and this is smaller than the integral square root of H of the maximum, but the maximum is of K maximum, okay, which is K lambda square times the integral square root of H, which is the volume, okay, smaller or equal. So the volume grows, apart from small corrections, implica, which you can read the paper to be slightly more precise, but V lambda is less than or equal than V zero e to the K lambda square lambda. So this plus this implies that the volume grows like e to the K lambda square lambda, okay? So the volume actually grows like the Sitter space. Okay, then 5 minutes, yeah. We got the volume, but what was the rate of change of the volume is the one of the Sitter space. So dV in dV lambda is K square, is the integral of K square. Okay, but dV in dV lambda is K lambda square, since it's K lambda square times V, which means that on average, now that the rate goes like this, means that the average of K square, which is the integral in D2X of square root of H K square over the volume, which is the integral of D2X, is equal to K lambda square. So on average, the sensitive curvature is the one of the Sitter space. This means in the L2 norm of K, the L2 norm, the L1 norm of K square converges to the one of the Sitter space. Okay. This means that if you integrate this equation now if you integrate this equation in space, okay, What do we get? So let's integrate. Let's integrate this in time. Integrate d2x square root of h. Okay. Okay. The first term give us. Minus 8 pi chi. Then the second term gave us plus k lambda square v lambda. This is the integral of k square, but the integral of k square gives us k lambda square times the volume. And this is equal. Okay, if you want, this is. Sorry. Then there is minus the integral of sigma square must be equal to one, okay, there was one half here, K lambda, the integral of the cosmological constant plus the integral of T mu nu and mu nu. Okay. Now, the interesting fact is that these two cancel, okay, and the volume goes to infinity. So, so this means that when you integrate over the whole manifold, goes to a constant, even though the volume is infinite, there is infinite volume, okay? So this means that the integral of sigma square is less than a constant, okay? Maybe to normalize it, we can put it with respect to K lambda square, and the integral of T mu nu and mu nu is also less than a constant. But the volume, maybe with a G Newton, but the volume is going to infinity, which means that this implies, okay, that almost everywhere, apart for a finite volume, a finite physical volume. Sigma square and T mu nu and mu nu, which I remind you they're positive, pointwise, are of order e to the minus k lambda square lambda, which is 1 over the volume. That is, if this integral over infinite volume must give me a finite number, it means that almost everywhere this, the size of these guys is of order 1 over v. And notice that these guys are positive, so the absolute value of these guys is small. So almost everywhere, the trace part, and since this is positive, also sigma mu nu directly is zero, because if sigma mu nu square is positive, since sigma mu nu is a special tensor, sigma mu nu is zero. If sigma mu nu square is zero, sigma mu nu is zero. Then almost everywhere, both the energy density and the anisotropic part of the stress tensor goes to zero. And notice that the dominant energy condition tells you that if T mu nu and mu, that tells you that the dominant energy condition tells you that this part of the stress tensor is the biggest component of all of them. So this implies that T mu nu in absolute value is less than T mu nu and mu and nu. And so all the components of the stress tensor goes to zero. So what have we proven so far? These special slices reach infinite volume like the city space. 1 minute, and I'm done. Then the Cc curvature is the one of the city space, and there is no anisotropic Cc curvature, and there is no matter. They're empty. Okay? And by asking an equation, now we can finish the proof. Since we proved that T mu nu is zero, almost everywhere, we use Astan equation. Astan equation basically tells us that R mu nu are equal T mu nu. I mean, R mu nu minus, one can write as minus 1/2 G mu nu T. This is another way to rewrite Astan equation with G Newton. So, and remember that there is the cosmological constant. So, but this is zero almost everywhere. We just show it. So this means that R mu nu of the 2 plus 1 dimensional space-time is the one of the city space almost everywhere. In the, if you want, in this sense here, which is the L2 set, the L1 sense, in the normal one, or one of the city space. But in 2 plus 1 dimensions, the Riemann in 2 plus 1 dimension is a known function in terms of the Ricci of 2 plus 1 dimension. Something like G mu nu, okay, now we get the index wrong, G R nu sigma 2 plus 1. So this is equal to this plus permutations and objects like this. And since we just showed that almost everywhere the Ricci is the one of the city space, this means that the Riemann tensor of a 2 plus 1 dimensional manifold is almost everywhere equal to the one of the city space. Okay, and this ends the proof. So in the L1 sense, or L2 sense, depends, for some quantities, there is a L1 sense or L2 sense, this manifold has evolved to an infinitely large region of space where there are some singularities, but there is a big region here probed by the mean curvature flow. And whenever the mean curvature flow reaches, the Riemann tensor is the one of the city space for arbitrary large volume, for arbitrary large volumes. There are some regions here which are still singular. So if you look at the late time manifold from above, there is an infinite volume, infinite full of Hubble patches. There are some black holes here and there, but there are infinite large regions here in the middle which looks like the city space in this L2 sense, okay. And since I'm a bit over time, I'll stop here. Thank you.